service of Book of Alternative Services. And this morning, for our call to worship, Travis is going to sing as we are gathered, Jesus is here. Sentence for today is our Savior Jesus Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And our opening hymn this morning is in your songbook, number 25, Come Walk With Me.
I met the Lord, he spoke to me.
And our service in your BAHIS begins with the penitential rite on page 45. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient heart confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. And say together, Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the introductory responses is page 47. Lord, open our lips. O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is our refuge and strength. O come, let us worship. And the Jubilati will say together, Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. And now for the proclamation of the word, beginning with the first reading.
A reading from 2 Samuel. After the death of Saul, when David had returned from defeating the Ammonites, David remained 2 days in Ziklag. David intoned his lamentation over Saul and his son Jonathan. He ordered that the song of the bow be taught to the people of Judah, and it is written in the book of Zazar. He said, Your glory, O Israel, lies slain upon your high places. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not to Gath. Proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkenaz. Or the daughters of the Philistines will rejoice. The daughters of the uncircumcised will exult. The mountains of Gilboa, let there be no dew or rain upon them, nor bounteous fields. For there the shield of the mighty was defiled, the shield of Saul anointed with oil no more. With the blood of the slain from the fat of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan did not turn back, nor the sword of Saul return empty. Saul and Jonathan, beloved and lovely, in life and in death they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you with crimson in luxury, who puts ornaments of gold on your apparel. How the mighty have fallen in the midst of the battle. Jonathan lies slain upon your high places. I am distressed for you, my brother Jonathan. Greatly beloved were you to me. Your love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. How the mighty have fallen, and the weapon of war perished. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle number 27, Glory to God. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Amen.
Psalm 130, page 888. Psalm 130. Out of the depths have I called you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears consider well the voice of my supplication.
If you, Lord, were to know what is done amiss, O Lord, who could stand?
For there is forgiveness with you, therefore you shall be feared.
I wait for the Lord, my soul waits for him. In his word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy.
With him there is plenteous redemption, and he shall redeem Israel from all their sins. Rescue us, O God, for whom we wait, from the depths of depression and despair. May we trust in your mercy, know the fullness of your redemption, and share in the glory of your kingdom through our Savior, Jesus Christ.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according with your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of fair balance between your present abundance and their need, and so that their abundance may be your need. And in order that there may be a fair balance, it is written, the one who has much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsory 5 on page 103. The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
God will help at the break of day.
We will not fear though the earth be moved and though the mountains be toppled into the depths of the sea.
God will help at the break of day.
Come now and look upon the works of the Lord. What awesome things he has done on earth.
God will help at the break of day.
Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
God will help at the break of day.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day. And our next selection is in your common praise, number 244, We Walk by Faith and Not by Sight.
Okay.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was ill of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brothers of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with them and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Okie dokie, when you're ready.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I am sure that there have been times in our lives when we have felt that we were at our wits' end. Life throws us all sorts of curves. Many things can bring us to that point. You get to the point where you have tried everything, but simply have no confidence that things are going to work out. Jesus, in his earthly ministry, touched the lives of many who were at their wits' end. He gave hope to the poor, and he offered forgiveness to those loaded with the cares of the world. He went about healing the sick. He lived his life following God's will. In today's gospel reading, we hear two stories about people whose lives are intertwined. They are stories of people at their wits' end, so to speak. First, a leader of the synagogue named Jairus came and knelt at Jesus' feet, begging him to come and lay hands on his young daughter, who was near death. As he responded to the man's plea, the crowd followed along. Then there is an interruption. The story of the healing of Jairus' daughter is put on hold as another story unfolds. In the crowd was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. Because of the strict purity laws of the Jewish people, such an ailment forced the woman to live in isolation. She was deemed unclean. Indeed, she had lost her whole fortune making the rounds of various doctors without getting any better. In fact, she was getting worse. She had heard about Jesus. If only I could touch his clothes, she thought, I would be healed. She held her way through the crowd. She touched the clothing, just the very edge, the hem of his garment. That was all she dared to do. That very instant, she felt power invading and healing her, and Jesus felt power leaving him. He wondered what he had felt. Who touched my clothes? He asked. The disciples laughed. You're in a crowd. Of course someone touched you. The disciples were right. Hundreds of people were touching Jesus that day, but nothing happened to them. The touching of Jesus had no power in and of itself. No power went out of him. Jesus realized that what happened was not merely a tiresome interruption, but a moment of immense significance for someone. That power came when the woman reached out in faith. Power comes when we reach out in faith. It happens at the moment when we share Jesus' vision, and in that sharing, we share his power. The woman was healed because she believed, because she took the initiative and reached out. Isn't that what Jesus told her? Your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. She brought her own gifts to the situation. She was determined to struggle and to overcome her condition, even when others would have become discouraged. She had hopefulness and trust, both amazing gifts to nurture within ourselves. Jesus never cured just an illness. He cured a sick person. His touch healed the body. His words healed the spirit. His love healed the heart. Jesus seeks a personal encounter with each of us. We should seek it too. It is available to us in many ways, but especially in the Eucharist. Even though we are many, each of us can encounter the Lord personally. Faith comes to fulfillment only in a personal encounter with Jesus. Then Jesus returned to the matter at hand. Some people came from Jairus' house, giving an update on the little girl's condition. She is dead. Don't trouble the teacher anymore. But it was no trouble for Jesus. Have faith, he told the father. Then he and the tree he allowed to follow him went to the house. Family and friends were already grieving the child's death. The child is not dead, she is just sleeping. Jesus and the disciples hear the sound of nervous laughter. Jesus goes in alone. Little girl, get up, he tells her, taking her by the hand, and she awakens. She gets up and has something to eat. Jesus made her feel as if she was the only person in the world. There is such gentleness and tenderness in the scene. Jesus showed such love for the young girl and for her parents. These are powerful stories of healing. They raise so many questions and feelings in us. We see here how faith took Jairus from a life of fear to peace. We see how faith took the woman from a life of suffering to healing. But faith does more than just makes us feel better. It connects us to Jesus. Every time Jesus healed someone, it took something out of him. The greatness of Jesus was that he was prepared to pay the price of helping others. We are following in his steps when we give of ourselves in helping others. Our lives are continually touching those of other people. Each of us is capable of doing some healing. We may not be able to cure, but it is within our power to care. And caring is a very healing thing. A compassionate heart can heal almost anything. With a little care, we could ease a troubled mind. With a little of our time, we could ease the pain of loneliness for someone. With a little sympathy, we could heal a wounded heart. Each act of caring will cost us something. Then there is a ministry of accompaniment, just being there with the sick person. It is a beautiful ministry. It calls for awareness, sensitivity, and self-forgetfulness. Sometimes there is nothing we can do for the sufferer, and nothing we can say either. In that case, our only ministry is that of simple presence. Like that of Mary at the foot of the cross, it is a ministry of powerlessness. Yet, just by being there, by standing alongside, we save the sufferer from feeling abandoned and offer something very precious, namely human comfort. Healing is not a task only for the individual. If we can create communities where people can get together, work together, and support each other, then healing becomes a part of everyday life. We believe in God. We pray, at least out of desperation. We try to follow his example, but when it comes down to it, we fail to allow Christ to be living and active at the center of our beings. We come to Jesus. We hear his words speaking to us from the gospel stories. We express our needs through the liturgy and in our prayers. We praise Jesus in the hymns we sing. We touch him as we receive his body and blood in the Eucharist. But we allow our feelings of guilt, our weakness, our failures, the tragedies in our lives to overwhelm us. A woman in the crowd reached out in faith and touched the hem of Jesus' garment and was healed. Jesus asked a grieving father to believe that God has begun working to make all things new, here and now. And his daughter was restored to health. Two people are renewed in faith and hope. So, what do we believe in when we feel we are at our wit's end? Looking around at the state of the world in which we live makes it doubly hard to believe in anything, much less miracles. When life brings us something so painful, so devastating, that it feels as if we are beyond what is humanly possible to endure, what do then? Where do we turn? Is there a way to face the devastating loss without giving up our faith? We can do as we often do and reach out to our friends and family for support. We can reach deep into our own resources, believing that our life is not over, that where one door may have closed, another is opening. Perhaps the most important thing is to look back at how God has been with us in the past. Look to the one who has carried us throughout our lives. Then perhaps we can be assured that God is working in and through all the heartbreak and suffering in the world to bring about new life. Let us know the healing touch of God in our lives. Let us be willing channels of God's healing grace. Amen. Travis will now sing the hymn, "She Touched the Hem of His Garment," and it's in your songbook, number 69.
Here.
Please turn now to page 52 for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, Saint M number 39 now in your songbook. Number 39, Jesus Remembered Me.
People, litany number 3, page 112. Let us offer our prayers to the source of all love and all life, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Merciful Lord, we pray for all who call themselves Christians, that we may become a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to the praise of Christ Jesus our Savior.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for John, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers, that they may remain faithful to their calling and rightly proclaim the word of truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for Elizabeth, our queen, for the leaders of the nations and all in authority, that your people may lead quiet and peaceable lives.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for this town and those who live here, the poor and the rich, the elder and the young, men and women, that you will show your goodwill to all.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the victims of our society and those who minister to them, that you will be their help and defense.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those preparing for baptism, for those recently baptized, that they may be strengthened in the faith.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for all the saints who have found favor in your sight from earliest times, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and those whose names are known to you alone. And we pray that we too may be counted among your faithful witnesses.
Lord, hear our prayer. And our colleague is on page 365. Page 365. Almighty God, you have taught us through your Son that love fulfills the law. May we love you with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength. And may we love our neighbors as ourselves, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And gracious God, we praise you for this gathered church. We thank you for this time of worship and all that it brings to us of renewal and strength. Nowhere in all our living are we so close to one another as when together we offer up our prayers and songs to you. We thank you for the goodly fellowship of which we are a part of, and for the holy privilege of helping to bear one another's burdens. We pray in the name of our Savior, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn this morning is in your songbook, number 36, The Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.